Okay.
And then
one should be on the camera. So you click, so try clicking scene. And camera's not on. So click video. Oh, click plus. There we go. Add one. I guess. Video capture device. So where is it? It worked last time. Well, where is the microphone audio coming from? The audio is coming from there, but the video is not. Let's X out of it and reboot it.
Go ahead and do that. I'm going to call people. How's it going? Good. Did it work anymore?
Yeah, it worked.
It does?
Yeah.
What did it do?
Just rebooted it.
All right, I'm going to send a sign-in sheet around the room if you'd all try to hang on that. Appreciate it. Anybody else need a pen, a pencil? Okay.
So I can email the link to myself so I can post it on Facebook.
Okay. So are we live now?
Yep.
We're streaming this too, so people can watch from afar. Come on in, welcome. So now I can just add that and find that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Good.
All right, thanks. All right, welcome. I'm Bill Collins, the owner of the school. What we're here to do is to give you a class to prepare you for your CDL permit test. I'm going to show you a packet of information here. Operating right. Okay, so got this packet of information, right? So starting at the top, first of all, to get a CDL permit, you need a valid Class D or higher driver's license. You need a certified birth certificate or a passport along with your license. What's a certified birth certificate?
With
a seal or stamp on it, okay? Now, if you were born in Minnesota, there is an online website you can go to order that. I think it's $35 or something. If you have any questions about that or don't have a certified birth certificate, have any questions about how to get that, let me know after class, and I can give you that link, okay? All right. You need to study the state CDL manual to pass your permit test. How many of you want to get a Class A? Okay, so the majority are doing a Class A. All right. So to get a Class A, you want to study sections 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6. Section 4 is on buses. 7, 8, and 9 are tanker, hazmat, doubles, and triples. So you don't need to worry about those sections at this stage of the game. If you want to add endorsements later, then you'd want to study those sections, all right? If you do want to do a bus, you have to add section 4. Now, here's something that's kind of interesting. We are prohibited from creating practice tests for you that are similar to the state test, okay? We're licensed by Minnesota Department of Department of Public Safety, not the Department of Education. And the Department of Public Safety does not allow us to give you practice tests that are realistic. So to that end, are we working?
No, the link didn't work. I got to see what other ones are
on. Okay. So the we have this website for you to go to, cdltest.co. Okay, that's on your packet there. And that gives you very accurate practice tests to do. I mean, they are dead on in the state of Minnesota. Now, there's a ton of practice test websites out there. This is the one that I found that is most accurate. I would highly recommend you use that one and that one only. And we'll be actually using that a little bit later on in our class today, okay? So that's your method of doing practice tests. Then, if you don't have a manual, you can download it off the internet. What I'm doing is allowing people that are live streaming to watch the same thing on the screen that I've got. So, mindriveinfo.org is where you get the CDL manual, okay? You can get it on a mobile device, but easily get it at home on the internet, okay? Now, one of the things that I like about studying the manual that way is that you can easily search things in the manual. So here I am at mindriveinfo.org. That's the website that's on your packet there, okay? I click on manuals. Then I click on the commercial manual, and there it is, okay? Now, some people have printed CDL manuals that are 2-3 years old. I highly recommend you use this one. It has been updated almost on a yearly basis. So I'd recommend that you use the online manual. But part of what's great about this system is that if you're looking for a particular subject, it's so easy to search on this sort of a format. If I hit Control F for find, a little find box shows up. I type in slack adjuster. And then every time I hit enter, it takes me to the next place where slack adjuster comes up in the manual. Okay. Afternoon, welcome. A little pack of information here for you. Yep, here, have a seat. So this makes it very easy to study with using that find searching process. So that's one of the things I like about the online manual. The other thing that you'll see in our packet that we've got there Number six, the manual also is available in, as an audio file at that same website. So let me go back to the main page here, which is mendriveinfo.org. Click on manuals again. And this time what I'm going to do is I'm going to scroll down. And you can see that we have all of these sections here on audio files. Okay. Let me go back to the manual. And I'm going to go back up to section 2 in the manual here. So here is the beginning of section 2 in the manual. Okay. If I go here and click on Driving Safely Section 2, it's going to read me the manual. I'll watch.
Section 2, Driving Safely. This section covers vehicle inspection, basic control of your vehicle, shifting gears, seeing, communicating, space management, controlling your speed, seeing hazards, distracted driving, aggressive drivers and road rage, night driving, driving in fog, winter driving, hot weather driving, railroad highway crossings.
Okay, so you see what's going on there? That audio file reads you word for word the manual. And for a lot of us, it's difficult to comprehend the information reading it, but we can comprehend it better listening to it. And the beauty of this, if you're sitting in front of a computer screen, you can have the manual on the screen and the audio playing, and you're listening to it, read the thing to you. Now, with any CDL permit test you take, you got to study sections 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6 if you're doing an A, just 5 if you're doing a B with air brakes. So anyway you cut it, you got to do section 2, okay? Now, if I go back to the audio file in section 2, look how long it is. See how long it is?
3 hours.
A little over 3 hours and 15 minutes. Okay? What'd you say? Damn? Yeah. It's going to take you a while to learn this. Okay? So, you know, sometimes people come into this proposition and go, oh, common sense, I don't need that to read the manual. Well, good luck. Let me know how that works out for you. Okay? Because reading the manual is the proper way to prepare for this. Okay? So, going back to my little handout here, you're going to need your Class D license in the first place. You're going to need a certified birth certificate. You got to study the manual. I would do practice permit tests. I would read the manual, those sections. Then I'd go take practice permit tests at cdltest.co. until I had it down where I'm getting like 98% right. And then I promise you that you'll breeze right through the permit test, okay? All right. Only one permit test on each subject is allowed per day. You can take one a day, but no more than that. The first and second attempt is free. There's no charge for the permit test for any particular section. First and second shot at it, okay? Now, if you fail two tests and you go back for a third, then they start charging you $10 each for those tests, okay? Now, the manual comes right out and says that the test is available on paper or with a computer. However, most of the exam stations are going to require you to take your initial test with the computer. Now, personally, I don't like the computer. The reason I don't is that one of the things I don't like about the computer is that the computer is scoring you as you go along. So you have to get 80% right, which means you can only get 20% wrong. If you're doing the computer, if you get a question wrong, it tells you. Well, I don't know about y'all, but me, I'm going to start counting up how many I got wrong. And that starts making me nervous. And now my performance starts to deteriorate because I'm distracted. Okay? So
One of the benefits of doing this on paper is there's nobody standing over your shoulder going when you get something wrong, right? But the other big benefit to the paper one is you can skip questions. And on the computer, you can't. Okay? You get a question on that computer, you got to answer it. You have no choice. It won't go on unless you answer the question. Well, with paper, you can go back. And then the benefit to me anyway is, okay, if I'm not sure what the answer to number 7 is, maybe question number 24 reminds me to the answer to question number 7. Make sense? So I like the paper. Again, most exam stations, and Bob, who is a former examiner here, that's their policy, right? That they won't give it to you on paper the first time.
That's right. They want you to try the computer at least once.
Okay. So then the second time, if you come back, if you don't make it the first time, when you come back the second time, if you want to do the paper, then I'd ask for that. Me, I'm such an obstinate little guy, I'd probably insist on the paper the first time, but I've been known to make my life more difficult than it needs to be. So you're probably better off just going with the flow and do the computer the first time and then do the paper the second time if you feel it's a benefit to you. The computers do have headphones available, so you can listen to that if you feel that's to your advantage. Now, the number of questions you're going to get for a Class B with air brakes is going to be 80 questions. If you're doing a Class A with air brakes, it's 100 questions. It's going to take you a while to do this. So you need to arrive at least an hour before they close. At least an hour. I'd say an hour and a half to be safe. Okay. As to where you go to take a road test, again, it's listed on this website. If we go back to mindriveinfo.org, close that. So I go back to the main page here, office locations. And you can type in your zip code. We're at 075 here, and we're looking for a place to take the knowledge test. And it'll give us address, hours of operation, a map, the whole nine yards. So downtown St. Paul, 445 Minnesota Street. They're open from 8 a.m. to 3:45. So I'd say you need to get there by 2:30 in order to take a Class A or a Class B test. The South Metro Exam Station, same hours. There's their address, 2070 Cliff Road, okay? So you can find the different locations on that website, okay? You can also take one section, subject matter at a time. So in other words, you don't have to take all three tests. If you're doing a Class A, you need three tests: general knowledge, air brakes, and combinations. If you want to just do combinations, or just do general knowledge before you do the other two, that's fine. They'll hold on to your scores. Okay, they'll maintain that. So you can do that. All right, now. The last sentence I got on this first page, it says you need to complete a CDL medical self-certification form when you get your permit, okay? What I'm about to explain to you is worth all the time you took to come here today. Just this, okay? This is a very confusing area. And I want to cover one more thing before I get to it. Citizenship documents. If you don't have a passport or a birth certificate with a U.S. birth, though, these documents are the things that will allow you to get your permit. So if any of you don't have aren't born in the U.S., that's what you need. If you have any questions, we can help you out with that later. Okay? So just giving you full disclosure as to what documentation you need. Okay. The last page of my handout here should be this medical form, okay? I've actually got it. Hang on a second. All right, so this is the commercial driver's license medical self-certification form, right? should be the last page in your handout, okay? Okay. Now, how many of you already have a DOT health card? Okay, one of you. Bring it with and check box number one. Category one, non-exempt. That means you need a health card. And you have to show it to them. And see, it says that in parentheses, current medical examiner certificate must be submitted. So you bring it with and you show it. Those of you that don't have a medical card, check category number two and hand it to them. Unless you're under 21. Anybody under 21? Then you check category number four. Okay? Now, category number one and category number two are for interstate. Okay? That's everybody 21 years of age and older. The category three and four are intrastate. That is for people 18, 19, or 20. It also includes people that can't pass a federal DOT health card but can get a state one. The criteria for passing the DOT medical is a lower threshold on the state level than it is the federal level. As an example, if you're insulin dependent, you cannot drive interstate. But if you're insulin dependent, you can get a Minnesota waiver and drive intrastate. There's also a lower threshold for vision, also a lower threshold for deaf. I've had some deaf customers over the years, and I have a customer right now that's out there driving truck. He's deaf, but they made him get an intrastate one first, and then after I think about a year, then they gave him a waiver for the interstate. So my point is that there are some medical issues that may keep you at the intrastate, staying within the state of the Minnesota level, before you're allowed to gravitate, move up to an interstate status. So that's what category three and four are. They are for people that are either under 21 or have a medical issue, right? So the rest of you is are category one or category two. If you don't have a permit, excuse me, a health card, check category two. I'm exempt, okay? Now, who's exempt? Well, people that are driving for their own personal purposes, okay? So for the sake of discussion, let's say that I win the lottery tonight. So I better go buy a lottery ticket, huh? So I win the lottery tonight, okay? Tomorrow my wife is going to expect a hobby farm with horses. Now, I'm not hauling the manure, okay? So I'm going to go next door. I'm going to buy a Peterbilt dump truck with an automatic transmission. She's going to have to come here to get her Class B license. Okay? I'll be back tomorrow morning, by the way, even if I win the lottery. Okay? She's going to have to come here to get her Class B, but she won't be operating commercially. Nobody's paying her to haul the manure. This is just her own personal little thing. Okay? So she doesn't need a health card. She doesn't have to follow hours of service regulations. Her truck doesn't even need to be inspected if she's doing this for personal use. Okay? See, all of these rules are for commercial use, not personal use, okay? So, if nobody is paying you to drive a truck right now, you do not need a DOT physical. The moment you get paid, now you're going to now you need a DOT physical, and you need to have shown the state of Minnesota that DOT physical, and it has to be on file with the state of Minnesota, okay? Is anybody a resident of Wisconsin? By the way, okay. All right. Now, incidentally, this whole medical health card situation has changed in the last couple of years, and that's one of the reasons that we have such a tremendous driver shortage right now. It used to be, for years and years and years and years, all we had to do as drivers is carry a health card in our wallet. That's all we needed. Health card signed in our wallet. We're good to go, right? The truck stop was selling blank ones for $4. How hard was it to have a health card in your wallet? $4, okay? So what happened is that people who couldn't pass a physical had health cards, okay? And they shouldn't. Well, the feds figured that out. And they created a system, took them a while, but it's now in place. And now there is this federal registry. Okay. So now if I want to, if I want a DOT physical, what I do is I go to the National Registry. So let me do a Google search on National DOT Registry. And this website from the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration comes up. I type in my zip code. And now it's going to tell me about nationally registered medical providers close to this zip code that can give me a legitimate DOT physical. And the first one on the list is Dr. Gina. She's a chiropractor up here in Marie Avenue in South St. Paul. Let me warn you, she's as cute as a bug. Your blood pressure will go up just, okay. So, and then there's Dr. Dan, okay. Dr. Dan is the doctor that comes here and gives DOT physicals on Monday afternoon, okay. He charges $60. If you're a student of ours, he'll charge you $45. There's a discount. But you see how Dr. Dan has this national registry number. Dr. Gina has a national registry number. And when you go to any of these nationally registered DOT providers, they take your information and put it in a national database. And then law enforcement can double check to make sure that you have a legitimate DOT physical on file. Okay. So now there's no phony cards out there anymore like there used to be. Make sense? Then what you do is you take that DOT physical and you go to the state of Minnesota and you show it to them. You fill out that form I just had on the screen, the medical self-certification form. You fill that out, sign it, give it to them along with a copy of your DOT health card. And then what they do is that they put that on your driver file. If I go back to MinDriveInfo.org, actually I have it here. Let me change that to, let me do it this way. Go back to MinDriveInfo.org. I'm going to go over here to DL status. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to type in my driver's license number.
You can look it up.
Okay.
C.
Well, wait a second. All right. Well, let's look yours up then. So this is going to be Bob. C what?
623-745-298.
Oop, wait a second. Okay.
430.
All right. So this is, wow, a new DL number has been issued to this person.
This is my old number.
Remember Are you kidding me?
No, it still comes up.
Really?
Yeah.
So if I type in my old number, it'll come up?
It'll come up, yes.
Obviously.
Yeah. Yeah, it still comes up, believe it or not.
Well, that's it.
All the information's correct.
Huh. Okay, so Bob has a Class A license.
Type 2 means it's a duplicate.
Okay.
Okay.
His Class D is valid. His commercial is valid. His driver's license expires on 6/8 of 17.
Sure.
His physical expires on March 21st of 18. So his physical is actually good longer right now than his license. Okay. That's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Has your endorsements on it?
So now I want to, hang on a second, I want to get rid of this. I'm going to go back to mine for a second here. So there's my record. Okay. Now, I'm going to go back to the handout I gave you. The handout I gave you, one of the pages gives you all the medical requirements. I'm not going to go through that with you. It's just there for your information. But I want to talk about this page that starts off with medical certificate renewal. Okay. So, it's really important you understand something. Your medical card expires at the longest every 2 years, maybe less depending upon your particular health situation. All right? So, in terms of renewal, A CDL holder be required to complete the commercial license medical self-certification and submit their valid medical certificate issued before the medical certificate on file expires. Generally, it expires every 2 years. Now, the Department of Public Safety will send a notice to the driver, last known address, 60 days prior to the expiration date of the medical examiner certificate that is on file in the driver's record. Okay? Let me move the screen here a little bit. All right, so then it says the driver must fax or mail the completed driver's license medical self-certification form, valid medical certificate to the DVS. That's, we often call it DMV because in California that's what they call the licensed people. In Minnesota it's DVS. So the DVS CDL unit or submit in person at a location that accepts license applications. It must be received on or before the expiration date of the last examiner certificate that's on file. If a driver does not pass a medical examination or does not submit the medical examiner certificate within 2 years of the date of last examination, the Commissioner of Public Safety will notify the driver that your CDL privileges are no longer valid.
That's why they send it 60 days before.
If you don't respond, you lose your CDL. Okay? If you don't respond and send in a completed medical the certification form, they take your CDL away. Okay? You may reinstate it within a year. If downgraded or voluntarily surrendered for more than a year, the driver must retake the applicable knowledge and road test to reapply for the CDL. What's going on here, people, is there are drivers out there who have received a form. Is it working just the way I want it? They've received this letter that says their certificate is expiring. They forget to respond to it. And when they forget to respond to it, they don't send anything. They take their CDL away. If it goes more than a year, then they have to go all the way back through the whole process again to get their license back. So let's go back to my record here again, okay? So what I want to show you that's interesting about my driving record is my driver's license expires July 1st of 2018. My medical certificate expires June 8th. Of 2017. Okay? Now, what that means is on April 8th, so a little less than a month from right now, the state of Minnesota is going to send me a letter telling me my medical expires on June 8th. If I don't respond, if I ignore that and don't do anything, on June 9th, I lose my CDL. Okay?
And I'm going to remind you too, because it's my birthday.
On June 9th?
8th.
Then look, a little over a year later, I go in and renew my license. And this has happened to people. This has happened to drivers that are driving for a living. Have you come across this? They go into the exam station, they pull out their license, they fill out the form, they walk up to the counter with their checkbook. Yeah, I want to renew my CDL. You don't have a CDL, sir. Lady, I've had a CDL for 32 years. What are you talking about? You lost it 13 months ago, sir. Ma'am, it's right here. I've had this commercial license for 32 years. I drive a truck for a little bit. I got a truck out there in the street. I got a CDL. Sorry, sir, you do not. Okay, why is it that you think I don't have my CDL? Well, because you didn't send in your medical card. Okay, I got a new one right here. Well, that's good, sir. Go ahead and fill out your paperwork there. We'll get you on the permit exam, and you can get your permit right away. Well, what do you mean, get my permit? I've got a CDL, man. Sir, your license, your CDL was taken away for more than a year. You have to start all over. You have to take your permit test. You have to wait 14 days. And then you'll be allowed to take a road test, and if you pass, you'll get your CDL back. You got to be kidding me, lady. I got a Coca-Cola truck sitting out there at the curb. What am I supposed to do? Well, you better call somebody, sir, because you don't have a CDL. Can you imagine how upset those people get? Okay. So you've got to remember that your medical card is going to expire. Okay. And when it expires, you've got to remember to send in a new form. Now, all you got to do is send in a new form. Okay. See if I can find the form here again. So you go back this self-certification form. Where have I got it? Right here. There we go. That's all you got to do is fill one out. And if you got a medical card, fine. Say you're category number one. If you don't have a medical card, category number two. It's that simple. And you can go into category number two exempt for 20 years. Doesn't matter. They don't care. All that means is, again, if you're exempt, that means you're not making any money with your license at that point. Make sense? Okay. So remember to fill out this form before your medical certificate expires and submit it. Okay. The exam stations have this form there. You are going to be required to fill this form out when you get your permit. And I tell you, some of these examiners don't even know what's going on. Because I hear people telling me all the time, they wouldn't give me my permit because I didn't have my medical card. Check box number two, sign it, and hand it to them. So the one I'm giving you today, use that form. It's their form. Put your information on it. Check either category one if you have a DOT health card. If you don't, check category number two. In your case, category number four, and hand it to them. And they'll look at it and go, okay. They don't know any better. Okay? Got that? Any questions with that? Okay.
So if you go in and get your permit, you're gonna, and you don't have your health card, you're gonna mark category one.
Two.
Category two. Okay. Now, when you go back for your road test, now you got your health card. Okay. Then you're gonna refill the form out again and mark it category one. So you're gonna redo it.
In my case, I have a medical card right now. I have to category two.
Yep.
Yes.
So when I pass the road test and everything, yeah, everything, I gotta go refill.
When you get your permit, you got to fill a form out. You'll fill another one out when you pass your test to get your license, okay? So you're going to fill two of them out any way you look at it. Now, if you still don't have your health card when you get your license, fine. Put category two, get your license. Then when you get your health card, go back there and show it to them. Check category number one, you're good to go, okay? Simple as that, all right? Okay. Let's go back to the manual. So I go back to my main page of the website here. Go back to manuals. All right. Now, the very beginning of the manual has a lot of very good information in it. But none of this in Part A is going to be on your permit test, okay? Now, the reason that I can assure you that is that there's actually a rule in play that anything on the test has to be in the manual. It's a federal rule. But Section 1 gives you a lot of good information about commercial license. On page one, they start talking about the weight classes, and then they talk about endorsements and restrictions. They'll give you the fees, the current fees that you that's going to cost you. You know, and here's another reason why I like using the one on the internet. Then at least I know the fees that I'm looking at are accurate. Talks about who's exempt. Talks about the knowledge test. The road test is next, skills test. Talks about that. Talks about the pre-trip inspection, the basic skills, the road test. Talks about the medical requirements. Gives you access to that information I've got in your packet in terms of the medical stuff. But here's all that medical stuff right here that I've got in your packet. Okay, if you have any questions, ask. There's actually a state rule that says the manual has to talk about bicyclists. There's a state rule that says the manual has to talk about zipper merge. There's a state rule that says the manual has to talk about mobile phones. Talks about implied consent, alcohol, railroad crossing stuff, school bus stuff, restricted seasonal commercial license restrictions, what can cause you to lose your license. It gives you some information about hazmat, including the information. These are the crimes that disqualify you for 7 years from getting a hazmat endorsement. And then there are additional crimes that will disqualify you for a lifetime, okay? Talks about fingerprints. And here again, if you want information about how to do this hazmat stuff, go to the website, because then what you're doing is you're getting today's information. Well, so many of these things are such a moving target. The hazmat process has changed 10 times in the last 8 years. Okay, I mean, there's just been all kinds of changes with hazmat endorsement. So go to the website, then you're getting the latest information, all right? I would even suggest you don't ask anybody here about hazmat information. I would suggest you go to the website. Because if you ask somebody at the front counter about hazmat information, they're going to tell you what they learned 2 months ago, and it's probably changed. So they're giving you misinformation, okay? All kinds of different websites are available here through the manual. Minnesota trucking regulations, maximum width, lengths, that kind of stuff, weights. All kinds of good information there. But none of that is on your test. Then there's a whole big section on school buses. You don't have to worry about that because you're not doing a school bus. Incidentally, if any of you are ever interested in becoming a school bus driver, the school bus companies do their own training and testing, okay? So you don't need to go to a commercial school to get a school bus license. Go right to the school bus company. State of Minnesota gives them the authority to test their own people. It's called third-party testing. So there aren't any private schools doing school bus training and testing. There's just no need for it because the companies themselves offer it. All right, now the driver's license manual, even though we're looking at the latest one on the website, this is a 2005 manual that's updated July of 2014. It's actually published by the American Association of Motor Vehicle Administrators, which is a trade group of essentially state clerks that do the licensing process. This first paragraph right here is a disclaimer that says, if you do something in this manual and you get a ticket for it, you can't use it in court. These are not the rules, okay? And that's what this sentence right here. Any opinions, findings, conclusions, or recommendations expressed in this publication are those of the authors and do not necessarily reflect the view of the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration or state statutes, okay? So this explains what this is for and where it comes from, okay? It's the purpose of this manual is to pass tests. Once you pass your test and get your commercial license, I would take this manual and recycle it, okay? There's misinformation in here. How many times, Bob, have you complained to the feds and had them change the manual? 3 times?
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's been several things in the manual that were blatantly wrong. And so
Section 10.
Bob actually complained right to the feds and got them to change the manual. What's interesting, the audio file I showed you earlier, that hasn't been changed. They still have no recaps on the front of the trucks on the audio file. All right, section one, again, a lot of good information. Nothing terribly important in section one about preparing for your test. Read it. I wouldn't worry about studying it too much, but do read it over. And then we get to the heart of this thing when we get to section two, okay? Now, here's something interesting. Those of us that have been licensed for many years, so both Gary and Bob fall into this category,
In the middle 1980s, the feds passed a law called the Motor Carrier Safety Act in 1984, and it created a bunch of changes in our industry that I won't go into. But one of the things that happened is that it required all of us that had a license to go back and retake written tests. Because the reality is, some of us that got our license, our commercial license, never took a test. So they made all of us go back and retake our written test. Well, a lot of drivers were struggling to pass the written test. Can you imagine how upset truck drivers were that have been driving for 25, 30 years, and now they can't pass the written test to keep their license? It's like, are you kidding me? I've been driving truck for 30 years, dude, and you're going to tell me I don't know how to drive a truck because I can't pass your stupid written test? So what they did, what the feds did, is they asked the American Association of Motor Vehicle Administrators to come up with a way of helping people prepare for the test. So what they did is, in each section of the manual, they created these little boxes titled Test Your Knowledge. And in these little Test Your Knowledge sections, they put questions. Those are the questions on the test. So what you want to do is you want to read through the manual. And when you get to one of these Test Your Knowledge sections, look at those questions and make sure you know the answers to those questions. Okay? Now, what I've done to help us study for this to some extent is I've created these little files here where we can go through and look at these questions one by one and then go back and look into the chapter to figure out what the answers are. So these first few pages are the things that I've just already been showing you out of the manual. There's the manual. There's that disclaimer page that I referred to. There's the index for section 2. And on page 28 is the first test your knowledge question, okay? And the first test your knowledge question is, what's the most important reason for doing a vehicle inspection? Well, the answer is on page 21. And what it says here is a vehicle defect found during inspection could save you problems later, okay? In terms of finding the correct answer, you're looking for what it says in the manual in terms of these multiple guess answers. And which one of those answers comes out of the manual? You need something? Underneath my desk, black door, top drawer. What things should you check for on a trip? On page 21, it says during a trip. You should watch your gauges, use your senses, and then check critical items when you stop, including tires, wheels, rims, brakes, lights, reflectors, brake electrical connections, coupling devices, and cargo securement. So that's going to be the correct answer to that question. Name some key steering suspension, key steering system parts. Well, there's a diagram on page 22 in the manual that lists them. So the text doesn't list these items, but this diagram does. Steering wheel, tie rod, steering shaft, power steering cylinder, steering arm, spindle, steering knuckle, drag link, pitman arm, gearbox, and hydraulic fluid reservoir. So any of those would be the correct answer. All right? Name some suspension system defects. Well, on page 23 in the manual, they talk about spring hangers that allow movement of axle from proper position, cracked or broken spring hangers, missing or broken leaves in any leaf spring. If 1/4 or more are missing, it would put the vehicle out of service.
And that's a question on the test. How many broken or missing leaf springs can you have before they'll put you out of service? 1/4 or more, 25% or more. That's a question in the test.
And part of what's interesting about this is we used to have the leaf springs over the years have significantly improved, okay?
in the old days, trucks would have many, many, many springs on them. I mean, here's an example of multi-leaf springs, okay? I don't know if you can see that very well. Yeah, that didn't work. But I don't know how many are there, 10, 12, 14, I don't know. Now, you don't see that anymore. Why? Because the springs have improved. So rather than a whole, well, here's a picture with a whole buttload of them.
Yeah.
I mean, back when I first started driving truck, right? There's three of us in the room here who have been around a few years, okay? And that's how many springs you'd have underneath your truck in back in the day, and now it looks like that, okay? Now it's like two, all right? Why? Because the metallurgical processes have changed. Well, back when it was these multiple springs, if you had 10 springs and two of them were missing, that's less than 25%, you can still drive that truck. So that's where that 25% comes from, okay? Well, now, with today's trucks, if you got two springs, how many can be missing?
No.
Well, none of them. You only got two, okay? So what's a little frustrating to me with the CDL manual is that there's so much information in there that's old school stuff. And just doesn't exist anymore. So we got to kind of weed through that as you go through this process of preparing for the test. But as Bob said, that question about 1/4, you can pretty well guarantee you're going to see that question on the test. If you got 1/4 or more of the springs missing, then that truck is out of service. In other words, cannot be driven legally or safely. What three kinds of emergency equipment must you have? Anybody know?
Fire extinguisher?
First aid kit.
Nope. In a bus, that would be true.
Triangles?
Fuses. Okay. And incidentally, those of you that read the manual, what's a fusee? A flare.
That's right.
A fusee is an old word for a flare. Okay. All right. So what kind of equipment do we have to have? Fire extinguisher, and it has to be properly rated, fully charged, and secured. Fire extinguishers, incidentally, in trucks, we carry BCs. They have to be BC rated, and only 5 pounds required. 5 pound bottle in a regular truck, 10 in hazmat. This is actually a 10 BC. This is all you need in a hazmat vehicle. Now, a lot of the, especially like the fuel tankers, carry much bigger bottles. But this is the minimum. Now, we don't have tags on fire extinguishers in trucks. Why? Well, tags are required for fire extinguishers that sit in a building because the fire extinguisher sits on the wall forever. Well, what happens when it's sitting there for all this time? Well, the compound in here settles, okay, and almost solidifies. Why don't we have to worry about that in a truck? Because we're bouncing down the road, shaking this thing up constantly. So we don't have tags on our fire extinguishers in the trucks. But there's going to be a gauge. It's got to be charged, properly secured, the proper rating. Okay? All right.
And it has to be strapped down. And it has to be charged. The needle has to be in the green.
Okay, three reflective triangles and then spare fuses. All right, what's the minimum tread depth for the front tires? Anybody know? For the front, it's 430 seconds. Okay. Now, tires are measured in terms of their tread depth in 32nd of an inch increments. It's just the way that the tire industry operates, okay? This is a tread depth gauge. Has a little probe here. The reader goes from 0 to 32. So to measure tread depth, you take the platform, put it between the two treads, push the probe down, and that tells you how thick your tread is. This little tread right here is 20, 21, 30 seconds, okay? Mm-hmm. So that's the way the tire industry measures tread depth, is in 30-seconds increments. When you take a test, answers like 1/16th or 1/8th are not correct. You want to answer in 30 seconds, okay? So that's why they do it that way, is because that's what the tire industry is doing. All right, so what about the rear tires of the truck? 2/30 seconds. What about the trailer? 2/30 seconds. Very good. Okay. So you need to know this stuff to get the correct answer on your permit test. Name some things you should check for on the front of your vehicle during a walk-around inspection. Well, on page 2-3, they talk about looking underneath for fresh oil, coolant, or grease, fuel leaks. That's what you'd look for on the front. What should a wheel bearing seal be checked for? Anybody know?
Leaking grease.
The seal's leaking, okay? So make sure they're not leaking. How many red reflective triangles should you have?
Three.
Three of them, correct. How do you test hydraulic brakes for leaks? Now, every commercial vehicle I know, over 26,000 pounds out there these days, has got air brakes. But they still have a little section in the manual, in section 2 of the manual, talking about how you check for hydraulic brakes, okay? And what you do is you pump the brake pedal. You pump the brake pedal 3 times and then hold it for 5 seconds, okay? 3 and then 5. So pump 3 times, hold for 5 seconds. The pedal should not move. If it does, you got a leak in your brakes, okay? So even though you're not driving hydraulic brakes, you still need to know that to pass your permit test.
Or they'll try and trick you, too. They'll tell you, pump 5 times, hold 3 seconds. No, it's pump 3 times and hold for 5 seconds, and it should stay fairly firm.
Okay, why put the starter switch key in your pocket during the pre-trip? So somebody doesn't drive off on you. That makes sense, right? That's on page 2-5 of the manual. Then we go to the next section of test your knowledge. Why should you back towards the driver's side? Well, on page 2-9, they tell you so you can see better, it's safer. Pretty self-explanatory. If stopped on a hill, how can you start moving without rolling back? And it tells you on page 2 of the manual to partially engage your clutch before you take your right foot off. But it also says use the parking brake when necessary. And it also talks about a trailer brake hand valve that a tractor trailer might have. Most semi-tractors have a lever on the dashboard that operates the service brake on your trailer. And so if you have that, the manual is telling you to do it. Now, this too is old school as far as I'm concerned. Today's trucks have so much torque, you don't need to do any of that park and brake, hand brake thing, okay? We're not driving a 72 Pinto, we're driving a diesel truck, okay? So you're on a hill, you've got your foot on the brake so you don't move, right? Put it in a lower gear, first or second, depending upon the situation, grade, and load. Let the clutch out a little bit so that you feel it start to engage, and take your foot off the brake. It's going to go all by itself. Feather the clutch out nice and smooth. You don't need to give it any throttle. Any of today's trucks, the fuel is electronically managed, such that as long as you're smooth on the clutch, it'll actually give itself fuel and you'll go. When I take somebody out in a 10-speed tractor for the first time, for demonstration purposes, what I like to do, this is the first time they've ever driven a 10-speed, I like to have them go through all 10 gears and never touch the throttle. So you start out in first gear, let the clutch out, no throttle, double clutch up into second, no throttle, double clutch into third. If we're on a level surface and we're not loaded, that thing will go right all the way up to 10th gear, never touching the throttle, just keeps accelerating. Okay, because of all the torque. So my point is, You don't have to worry about stalling on a hill or rolling back on a hill the way you would with some old clunky piece of junk car, okay? It's so much easier to operate. So don't worry about it. But manual says use your parking brake or hand valve, so that's going to be the correct answer on the permit test. When backing, why is it important to use a helper? Well, according to page 2-9, it eliminates blind spots, okay? What's the most important hand signal that you and the helper should agree on?
Stop.
And there's lots of different signals for stop. Some people use the closed fist. Some people do double fist. They could do this like that. I mean, there's a whole bunch of signals you could use for stop. And the point is that you got to agree on them. Let me ask you this also, the departure from the manual. If you were using a spotter, when backing up, if that spotter moved on you such that you lost sight of him or her, what should you do?
Stop and get out.
Stop and get out and find him. Okay? Just no ends or buts about it. If you've lost sight of them, you get out, you find them. Okay? So, stop. Two special conditions where you should downshift. Well, according to the manual, before starting down a hill, this is page 2-9, and then before entering a curve. Okay, right out of the manual. When should you downshift automatic transmissions? Well, here again, this is old school information. The correct answer is before you start down a hill. But with today's technology, it downshifts automatically. I have a little pickup truck with a little diesel engine in it. And it automatically downshifts on the grade. I don't need to touch it. Does it all by itself. Okay? I do have a switch to turn the engine brake on and off. We'll get to that in a minute. But it downshifts itself. Okay? I don't have to do it. But according to the manual, you're going to downshift before starting down a grade. Retarders keep you from skidding when the road is slippery. True or false?
False.
Okay? So first of all, what's a retarder? Okay, so I want to look at what the manual says about retarder here real quick. So we'll go back to the manual. I'll do a search.
I'm going to be leaving. All right.
Okay.
I'll be back tomorrow.
All right. Sounds good. All right. So page on section 234 of the manual, it says some vehicles have retarders. Retarders help slow a vehicle, reducing the need for using your brakes. They reduce brake wear and give you another way to slow down. There are four basic type of retarders: exhaust, engine, hydraulic, and electric. All retarders can be turned on or off by the driver. On some vehicles, the retarding power can be adjusted. When turned on, retarders apply their braking power to the drive wheels only, whenever you let up on the accelerator all the way. Because these devices can be noisy, be sure you know where their use is permitted, okay? When your drive wheels have poor traction, the retarder may cause them to skid. Therefore, you should turn the retarder off whenever the road is wet, icy, or snow covered, okay? So, what's going on here is that there is a device in the exhaust system, is the way this works, okay? It referred to an electric retarder. I don't even know what an electric retarder is.
Do you? I have no idea what they're talking about.
Okay. So what a retarder does is that it causes compression to increase on the exhaust cycle of these motors. So it causes more back pressure, and that's what's causing the braking effect on your drive wheels. Now, retarders are also called engine brakes, and then the nickname for them is Jake Brake. And the nickname Jake Brake comes from Jacobson Company that were the original builders of these engine brakes, okay? And what the Jacobson system does is it literally keeps the exhaust valves closed longer than ordinarily so as to cause a back pressure when the piston is trying to push the exhaust out of the cylinder head, if you have the technical experience to know what I'm talking about. Now, you don't need to know what I'm talking about. Just trust me. When the engine brake is on, it is causing drag, therefore a braking effect on the drive wheels. Okay? Now, as the manual told you, you should be careful when there's restrictions. What's the problem with engine brakes? Some of them are very loud.
Which ones are allowed? The guys, the owner operators that run around with open exhaust. These are the same guys that run with open exhaust on their Harleys. Okay? When they bought that Harley over at the dealership over here on the freeway, it had a perfectly quiet exhaust system. And they chose to open it up because they think making noise is cool. Okay? Well, that's exactly what these truck drivers are doing. They think it's cool to make noise, so they have open exhaust. And that's the ones you hear rattling the windows when the engine brake is applied. Okay? And so the cities don't like that. And so there are a lot of cities that put up noise ordinances. Some of them have enacted anti-engine brake ordinances. But the point is, two things. You don't want to make noise. So as long as you've got a stock original equipment exhaust system, you shouldn't have any problem whatsoever using your engine brake, okay? Now, the engine brake should be used whenever you're on a grade as your primary source of reducing or keeping your speed in check. So if you're going down a hill, I want you to have your engine brake on. Why? It saves wear on the brakes, reduces the brake fade, and thus improves the performance of your brakes, okay? So it is the safer way then to go down the grade, all right? Now, the manual just told you that using your engine brake will cause a skid. So you're not supposed to use it then when it's slippery. How do you deal with going down a hill then when it's slippery?
Keep it at speed limit, pump the brakes until you're 5 miles under the speed limit, and then coast.
That's under normal traction conditions. What you're talking about is exactly what you do under normal traction conditions. And we'll actually see that a little later on in this process. Here's what you do when it's slippery. Don't go down the damn hill. Okay? Now, I've operated this business for a little over 19 years. We're in our 20th year, okay? A truck and trailer is most treacherous when it's empty. These things, when they're loaded, you could drive through snowbanks with them. But you empty them out, and you're like a skateboard on ice, man. I mean, you just have no traction when you're empty, okay? Now, all of our test trucks are running empty all the time. We've been operating empty test trucks in Minnesota 12 months of the year for going on 20 years, and we've never crashed one. How? Because we're very conservative when it gets slippery. And one of the things we do is we avoid going down hills. Even with my pickup truck, I had to go to a meeting here a month or two ago, and there was a snowstorm. And I had to go to downtown St. Paul or something, right? So the shortest route for me is to pull out of here, get up on the freeway, go down Highway 52 into St. Paul. I didn't do that. I went over here, went down Highway 61. Why? I want to avoid that hill. Those of you familiar with Highway 52, from Butler down to State Street, it's a shooting gallery when it's slippery, okay? And I'm not doing it, okay? I am extremely conservative with how I drive these things when it's slippery. I am the slowest guy on the road when it's slippery. And this is what I do for fun. I drive race cars. Now, I road race. See, this is a Corvette, okay? What do you suppose happens in road racing when it rains? What do? Put on rain tires and our windshield wipers and we keep going, okay? We race in the rain. I'm not afraid to drive when it's slippery. In fact, it's fun. That's Blackhawk. I'm not afraid to drive when it's slippery, but I'm very, very disciplined with how I drive these things to ensure that it's safe. So while the manual and the question is telling you don't use retarders when it's slippery, you got to understand, well, now you can't go down hills. I mean, if it's that slippery that you shouldn't be using your retarder, avoid the hill. Find a different route to get there. And if you can't find a different route, then hold up for a while. Make sense? The Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration puts it squarely on our shoulders to make the decision as to whether we drive that truck or not based on conditions. And if the conditions are such we can't drive it safe, then you are not to drive it. Okay? All right. So false. They will cause a skid. What are the two ways to know when to shift? Engine speed and road speed. That's on page 29 of the manual. Next section. How far ahead does the manual tell you you should look? Well, you got to read the manual. You wouldn't know what the correct answer is without reading the manual. It's 12 to 15 seconds ahead. What are the two main things to look for? Well, again, the manual says, I mean, you can come up with answers based on common sense, but on page 2-1 of the manual, it says look for traffic and look for signs and signals. Most important way to see to the sides and rear of your vehicle? Well, that you could figure out by yourself. That's your mirrors. What does communicating mean? Signaling. Where should your reflectors be placed when you're stopped on a divided highway? Anybody read the manual and know? If it's divided, all three of them are behind you. First one at 10 feet, the next at 100, the next at a distance of 200. What if it's a two-way roadway? Well, then one is in front of you at 100 feet, two behind you at 10 and 100. What if there's a curb or hill? Then between 100 to 500 feet with the furthest. All that's in the manual. All that's fair game on the permit test. What three things add up to total stopping distance? Well, according to the manual, perception distance, braking distance, and reaction distance. Now, when you get into talking about driving air brakes, a vehicle with air brakes, there's also a fourth component called brake lag, but in section 2 of the manual, they haven't discussed it yet. So as far as general knowledge question goes, the correct answer is perception, reaction, and braking. Don't worry about brake lag unless you're dealing with the air brake test. Now, if you go twice as fast, will your stopping distance increase by 2 or 4 times?
4 times.
Another interesting question about braking. Empty trucks have best braking, true or false?
False.
You know, I'll be honest with you. The first time I saw that question, I got it wrong. I'm a race car driver. What kind of race car performs better, the heavy one or the light one? The light one. But see, what you got to factor in is trucks are designed to haul weight. And just as I was telling you a minute ago, when I'm heavily loaded, I can plow through a snowbank. And when I'm empty, I'm sliding all over the dang place. So it has to do with how many tires are on the ground and the width of the tires and what their capacity is. And this performs best actually when it's loaded. And the worst, the most treacherous configuration of these trucks is this right here. If it's slippery out and you're running without a trailer, we call that bobtail. Okay? This is treacherous. These things don't stop. They don't go. They don't turn. They're terrible. Okay? So you got to factor that into how you're driving the truck. So the correct answer is false. What is hydroplaning?
Skipping across water.
When there's water on the road and your tire literally rides on the water rather than touching the roadway, and now you have broken traction and you have lost control of the vehicle. What is black ice? Well, that's ice. It's so thin and so clear that you can't see the ice. You just see the road. So they refer to that as black ice. Next section. How do you find out how many seconds of following distance space you have? Well, when the vehicle ahead of you passes an object, you start counting 1,001, 1,002, until you get to that same spot, and that tells you how far back you are. Going back a few questions. How much space are we supposed to have? Or wait a minute. How far ahead are we supposed to be looking? I'm sorry. How far ahead are we supposed to be looking? 12 to 15 seconds. Yeah. Okay. Now, in terms of following distance, there's a formula in the manual. And so the question you're going to see on the test is, if you're driving a truck that's X feet long and you're going X speed, how much distance are you supposed to have? And the formula is this. First off, 1 second for every 10 feet of vehicle. So a 30 foot should be 3 seconds, a 40 foot, 4 seconds, a 50 foot, 5 seconds, etc. Okay? And then add 1 second if you're over 40 miles an hour. So the question here, 30 foot truck, that's 3 seconds. We are over 40. Add another second. So the correct answer is going to be 4. All right? So one second for each 10 feet of vehicle length. And then 1 second additional if you're over 40 miles an hour. So you should have, with a 73-foot over-the-road rig, you should be 8.5 seconds away from the guy in front of you, okay? Now, when I mention that, sometimes people say to me, how in the world are you going to maintain 8.5 seconds of following distance in heavy traffic? The answer, that's really, really, really simple. You drive 2 or 3 miles an hour slower than the traffic flow. And then everybody's always pulling away from you, okay? You're not tailgating and you're not going with the flow of traffic. You're going less than the flow of traffic. It's that simple, okay? How you should decrease your following distance if somebody's following you too closely. True or false? False. If they're following you too close, you should increase your distance. If you swing wide to the left before you turn right, another driver may try to pass you on the right. Is that true or false? That is very, very, very true. If you don't know that now, you will learn it. What's a hazard? A road or other road user. A road condition, I should say, or the road user. Why make emergency plans when you see a hazard? So that you can react to it better. Okay. My next file here, continuing on these test your knowledge questions. Now we're up to page 226 in the manual. What are some tips to follow so you won't become a distracted driver? Well, it gives you a whole buttload of them. How do you use in-vehicle communication equipment cautiously? Well, first of all, remember you cannot use a handheld cell phone in a commercial motor vehicle. Not allowed, okay? How do you recognize a distracted driver? See, all of this is in section 2 of the manual. And so you got to read this stuff in order to identify the correct answers, like vehicles that drift or inconsistent speeds, drivers that are preoccupied, or they appear to be involved in conversations. What's the difference between aggressive driving and road rage? They talk about it in section 2 of the manual. Aggressive driving is being selfish, bold, or pushy. Road rage is operating in a way to intentionally do harm to others. What should you do when confronted with an aggressive driver? Well, first of all, avoid eye contact and stay away from them, okay? I would suggest you don't make your own hand gestures. What are some things you can do to relieve stress before and while you drive? Listen to easy listening music. That's what it says in the manual. Okay. Next, test your knowledge box. Okay. You should use low beams whenever you can. True or false? What do you think?
False.
False. See, the assumption here, if you answer true, you're thinking of driving when there's traffic around. And these guys don't assume that. They're assuming there is no traffic.
Tricky question.
So it is a tricky question. But see, if you've read the manual, what you got to do to answer these questions properly, you got to go, okay, now wait a minute, what did the manual say? Not what would you do or what's common sense, but what did the manual say about that? Oh, yeah, the manual says, no, you're supposed to use high beams whenever you can. It says some drivers make the mistake of always using low beams. I don't know about y'all, but I always use my high beams when there's nobody coming at night. What should you do before you drive if you're drowsy? Sleep. Okay, now this is an interesting question because this is getting into the old technology of trucks. Our trucks, even the brand new ones today, still have drum brakes. Now, nobody that drove here today has drum brakes on their car unless you drove a 62 Chevy Nova. Okay, anybody got a classic car out in the parking lot? Okay. Drum brakes, when they get wet, they don't stop properly, okay? So the manual talks about this. And it talks about standing water, avoid driving through puddles if you can. If you have to go through a puddle, put your foot on the brake and drive with your foot on the brake a little bit. That warms them up and dries them out. With disc brakes, you don't have to worry about that, but drum brakes you do. And the interesting thing is that disc brakes have been around for trucks and trailers for probably a decade, but nobody specs them that way. If I bought a brand new truck, if I went to Peterbilt next door and specced out a truck to be built, I'd get it with disc brakes. In the long run, they're cheaper, they're easier to maintain, they last longer, they're lighter, all kinds of advantages. Why the industry hasn't embraced it is beyond me. There's a lot about the trucking industry that has an attitude of, my granddaddy did it that way, my daddy did it, I did it, and by golly, son, you won't do it that way. It's just old school mentality, okay?
The drum in front of it.
Yeah. Every single one of them,
first
okay?
First ones I saw, 2014 Freightliners. They put disc brakes
on. You can get them.
First one.
Yeah, you can get them. I mean, every manufacturer has it as an option.
So they have options for disc
brakes. Yeah, and on the trailers. I mean, you can get the entire combination with disc brakes, but nobody does it. What outfit did disc brakes? Whose trucks did you see with discs?
The ones we had.
At Century, really? Yeah. Oh, okay. Cool. On the front or rear? Or all?
Just on the front.
Okay. Just on the front.
Confused the hell out of everyone.
No, I'm sure it did. How do you adjust the slack adjuster? Yeah.
Well, how can you have disc brakes there? No, we've got drum and linings here, you know.
Yep. Okay. All right. Question number four. You should let air out of hot tires so the pressure goes back to normal. True or false?
False.
Don't do that. You can safely remove the radiator cap as long as the engine isn't overheated.
False.
What factors determine your selection of safe speed when going down a long, steep downgrade? The weight, the length of the grade, the steepness of the grade, road conditions, weather. Okay. Maximum safe speed, that's what you were talking about earlier. Okay, that 5 miles an hour thing. That question does come up too. But let me address this real quickly. So you're a rookie driver, right? And you're coming up to a grade that you've never been down before. How do you figure out what speed to go down the grade? It's real simple. Slower than the guy in front of you. Okay? I'm telling you, 80 or 90% of the guys going down them hills are going down too dang fast. Okay? Now, okay, so I'm going down a grade and I'm using my engine brake. All right, I am conservative, okay? Remember, this is a race car driver. But I'm very conservative going down this grade. And what am I using? I'm using my engine as my primary braking source, right? So I'm very conservative with this speed thing. I'm on the engine brake. When necessary, I use the brake. And the way you're supposed to use the brake when you go down a hill is that you push. There's a top safe speed, which you were referring to. Okay, and you want to start down 5 miles an hour under that top safe speed. If the speed climbs back up to the predetermined top safe speed, then you use the brake pedal firmly, slowing down 5 miles an hour within 3 seconds. Now, this is kind of interesting. Remember back to the hydraulic brake check thing? How many times did you pump it?
Three
times. How long did you hold it?
Five seconds.
Now, you flip this around here. Now you're holding it for 3 seconds, reducing by 5 miles an hour. Okay? That's the correct answer. But I want to bring this to your attention when it comes to these downgrades, okay? So I'm going down this hill, and I'm using my engine brake as my primary source of keeping the speed in check or reducing speed, which means there's some sort of compression thing going on in the motor hooked up to the drive wheels. Now, what happens if a U-joint breaks? Now what? Now how do I keep the speed in check? Brakes. That's all I got now, right? I lose my engine braking effect. You understand that? What happens if the clutch goes out? I have no mechanical braking effect anymore. Okay? Now all I got is my brakes. See, and if all I have my brakes, what's the potential problem?
Overheating,
fading, lose the brakes, okay? What if the crankshaft breaks? What if the flywheel comes apart? What if the transmission comes apart? Do you understand what I'm concerned about here? If a mechanical failure occurs when I'm doing this, then where am I? All I got is my brakes. So now do you understand why I'm so conservative?
These other guys that are going down the hill faster than me are relying on the fact that nothing's ever going to break. Well, I know better. And because I'm operating conservatively with my speed, if I do get into a mechanical problem, I'm going slow enough where I should be able to deal with it with brakes only. Make sense? So that's why I'm so conservative with this. I'm leaving a little bit on the table. I'm not taking that risk, right? I'm going home to my wife tonight. All right, I got a couple minutes left. Here's what I want to do the last couple minutes. I want to go to the website that I've been telling you to use, and we're going to do some practice tests on there. So the website is cdltest.co. So here's what it looks like. And look at all the different options you got. General knowledge part two, true false, hazmat, hazmat challenge, air brake, combination, pre-trip, doubles, triples, tankers, passenger, school bus, class A part one, class A part two, class B part one, part two. All right, let's just do the class A part one. And here's the first question. What is the most important hand signal that you and the helper should agree on? Do you see how accurate this practice test is? That's right out of the manual, isn't it? Because we just went over it. Let's see what the next one is. What's an escape ramp? Well, we didn't get to that section in the manual, but it's this one, a ramp leading to a long bed of loose, soft gravel to slow a runaway vehicle, sometimes in combination with an upgrade, okay? Name two situations legal maximum weights may not be safe to haul. That's right out of the manual. I can tell you that. Okay. Yep. What factors will not cause brakes to fade or fail? Will not cause. Now, see, this is kind of a tricky question. Okay. Which factor will not cause the brakes to fade or fail? Boy, this question really sucks. So which factors will not cause the brakes to fade or fail? Well, brakes that are out of adjustment will cause them.
C and D.
A, they fade or fail from excessive heat, so that's true. C, using the engine brake and not using the brakes often enough, well, that's true. Mismatched retread, yeah, okay, let's go with C and D, so that's here. Let's see how we do. Correct answer is, good job. What's hydroplaning? We had that one, didn't we? That's water on the road. Question six, what might happen if the trailer is too high when you try to couple? Well, it will not couple properly. It tip over and flip. Okay. Some common medicines for colds can make you sleepy.
True.
Air brake systems. All air brake systems have alcohol valve operator for alcohol in the air system.
True.
No, not all of them do. Not all. A lot of them. When backing, why is it important to use a helper? Well, that was right out of the manual that we already covered, didn't it? And it was the blind spots. Remember that? That section talked about the blind spots, okay? It's good to have somebody else around to blame if you hit something. The air compressor governor controls when the air compressor will pump air into the brake safety valves. No, it's regulating air pumped into the tanks, not the safety valves. Letting up on the brake pedal increases air pressure and releases the brakes. Letting up on the brake pedal increases air pressure and releases the brakes. While it releases the brakes, but you know, let's see what they say here. Yep, it is wrong because it doesn't increase air pressure. Okay. Two causes of tire fires. Underinflated and duals that touch. Okay. Which of the following is not a common cause of vehicle fires? Loose air lines.
When using your fire extinguisher, you get as close as possible to the fire. False, unless you're a fireman. You should decrease your following distance if somebody's following you too close. You see what I'm pointing out here? This is right out of the manual. These are the questions on your test, okay?
True.
You should decrease your following distance. No, we're not going to do that. Wheel bearing seals. Do you see how accurate this is? Okay. So that's my point, is that CDLtest.co is an extremely accurate practice permit test. Now, what I'm recommending you do is that you read through the manual. Stop at those test your knowledge questions. If you're not certain of the answer, take a highlighter, go back into that section and find that information, okay? Then once you've read it all the way through, then go to CDLtest.co and practice until you get good at it. Now, there are some people that will kind of cheat, and they'll forget the manual part and just go to CDLtest.co. You won't be as well informed that way. You might be able to pass the test that way, but you won't be that well informed. One more suggestion I have for you. If you go take your test tomorrow on Wednesday and you fail any one of those tests, where do you suppose I would suggest you be on Wednesday? No, right back there taking the test. Because what you got wrong on Wednesday, you have a better chance of remembering that on Thursday than you can do Tuesday of next week. Make sense?
Yeah.
Gentlemen, do not get discouraged if you fail any of these tests. Look, I taught driver's ed for years, and I did practice tests with the high school kids. And when I sat down to write a question, I'm literally thinking about this. How can I do this so that the correct answer is not obvious? I mean, you don't show a picture of an orange construction sign and then ask people what color construction signs are. Okay? All right? You got to make a question at least a little bit tricky so that people have to think at least a little bit to get the correct answer. That's the intention of the person that wrote the test. And some of these questions, like the way they're worded, I mean, there was that one, I forget even which one it was now, but I had to stop and think about it and really read it. It was the one about the brakes, wasn't it? I mean, the way they phrased the question. So don't feel bad if you fail one of these things, okay? Don't feel bad at all. And even if you got to go back for a third time and pay $10, big deal, okay?
Are they timed?
There is no time limit. Good question. There's no time limit. But that's why they want you early enough so that you got enough time to finish it before they close. Yep. They don't want to boot you out of it. So they want to make sure you have plenty of time to do it. Okay? So they won't let somebody come in at the last minute. All right? Any questions? Yes, sir.
So we have to pass the three tests the same day, or I can do it?
No, you can do them different days. Okay. You can take just combinations.
Right.
Get that taken care of, and then come back the next day and take air brakes. Get that taken care of, and then come back and do. Well, wait a minute. Do they do make them to general knowledge first?
No.
You can take one of the other ones first. Okay. So combinations only has 20 questions. Air brakes has 30 questions. General knowledge has 50 questions. So if you want to start with a small one or start with a big one, it's your choice, okay? And then just kind of keep adding it up, and then you get to those three, and now you can get a Class A license, all right? And it certainly doesn't hurt to have endorsements like tanker, doubles and triples, hazmat. There's more to it because you got to do the FBI background check and pay a FBI background fee. So there's more to the doing the hazmat.
It's going
to
cost you, too.
But doubles and triples and tanker is just written tests. So even with a Class B, I'd recommend the tanker.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, that'll do it for today. If you have any questions about the school, Josh or I will be out at the counter up front, so you can check with us there.
Since you came in late, if you put your information on the side sheet there, please.
All right, thank you all.
Yeah,
all
right, great. Thank you.
So I'm going to put on this video for Maury. Well, I got a gentleman that... I got to figure out where it is.
So do you have to keep taking your physical like over and over again every 2 years?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's kind of what I was getting out of that.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Where's our drop and hook video? What class is that in? Oh, here. It's in this one.
Fading down the field. I don't know if I've seen that.
Here we go. No, that's not what we wanted.
The video you want to look at?
Yeah.
Your video?
Mm-hmm.
Drop and hook?
Yep.
Okay. It's under. Let's see.
Hang on, it froze up on me.
Okay.
Let me go find.
One question.
Okay.
Wait, Jim, this one of the
it's not.
Right, 2 weeks of class,
right,
and then driving. And the driving you set up with Pat.
Oh,
okay. So you sit down with Pat.
To drive like up to bring the
permit.
The permit, right?
Yep. Thank you. Sure.
For a Buckner church, it's the same one of those that other companies use.
Well, the FBI background check for the hazmat thing is through Homeland Security.
So that's a whole separate thing. Okay. And that costs like $90 to do that background check.
This isn't the case.
You don't do that through here. You do it through the Homeland Security. That's not a problem.
Okay. No.
It's the ITDS one. The ITDS?
There it is. Yep, that's it.
So let me get this guy before we start this thing here.
Oh, okay. Oops. All right.
Oh. It's Bob, right?
Bob, yeah.
And you're glad? I'm Gary.
Gary. Okay.
I tell you what, I was glad that you were talking about the Smith system.
Oh.
Nobody ever said that.
Yeah.
I haven't worked with that for almost 6 years, but still I can say A-mine, steering, imaginary target, baseball, dartboard, center's vehicle, and traffic lane, safe path,
yeah.
Steering, find a safe path, well, ahead.
Yeah.
It'll never go away.
Yeah.
And it works.
Doing, drive along or...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. So have a seat. I'm going to show you a video.
Okay.
And then when this video is over, I'm going to have you work with Gary.
Okay.
This is Gary. Yep. This is Gary. This is Maury. So you watch this video, run you through the drop and hook thing, and then you guys will go out, use your truck, my trailers, and do some drop and hook.
Sure.
If you have any questions about what's going on here, Gary, you can pause the video.
Sure. And then my truck tires are a little bit bigger than average.
Do you have a dump valve for your suspension?
Yes.
Okay. So.
Okay. You can watch it through my
First thing you have to do is make sure the height is right.
Right.
Exactly.
And if you can't make it right with the dump or whatever, then
leave that on, Bob.
You're going to have to adjust that.
No, I just have to show it.
Yeah, I will.
I'm a newbie. I'm below a newbie.
But yeah, you can just basically you make that decision and then you adjust.
Yep. When I run a video, I turn these off and leave them on.
Oh.
See, this video is going to walk you through this whole thing.
Okay.
But then Gary, who's got years and years and years of experience, is going to put you through it and answer any questions you have.
Okay.
Okay?
All right.
So this will all make sense.
Okay.
And I'm going to have
I'll put you at ease because if you do what I'm going to tell you to do, it will not come unhooked until you pull the handle.
All right.
So if you want to pause this, if you have any questions, feel free to do that. Okay. If you want the mouse, you can do it from there.
No, I can do it.
You can do it from right there.
Okay.
So then you can see the mouse.
Yeah, okay.
So then you just
stop it. Yep.
There.
Okay.
Okay.
keep my account with Interstate Now, before you hook up to a trailer, do a semi-trailer. You want to inspect your fifth wheel. We have a separate CDL safety tips video just on that subject alone. So I'm going to forego a discussion about the fifth wheel for the moment. Now, one of the things you'll notice about a semi-tractor, the frame rails on a semi-tractor are not straight. They are angled down. The whole idea here is we're going to go underneath the trailer and pick it up with this tractor, okay? So the frame rails are angled down. And the other thing you'll notice, if you look at the fifth wheel itself is angled down. There are pivot points on the fifth wheel, right here, where this fifth wheel can pivot back and forth. That's in order to accommodate the difference of terrain. When you're picking up a trailer, the fifth wheel should be slanted so the rear of the fifth wheel is down, so that we can scooch underneath the trailer. Let's go to the trailer for a second. So what we're going to do, I'm going to bring the tractor back here in just a second and position it so that we can check this. But we want the frame rails to go underneath the trailer. The frame rails can't hit the front bulkhead or we won't be able to hook up to it. We don't want there to be a gap between the fifth wheel and the trailer. So we're going to check the height of this in just a minute. But that's what we're doing, is we're getting in so that we can pick this trailer up. You look underneath, the kingpin is anywhere from 24 to 36 inches back, and that's what we're going to hook up to with the jaws on the fifth wheel. One of the considerations is that we come in nice and straight. Now this trailer, as you can see, there's a little white line down the side of the trailer. The trailer is nice and straight. So as I back up, I'm going to be watching my driver's side mirror, especially to make sure that I'm very evenly lined up with this trailer as I come in. The reason that's so critical, if you look at the landing gear back here, this landing gear is structurally supported fore and aft so that as you come back to hook up into it, if you inadvertently push the trailer backwards, this is structurally sound enough to support that. You see a big I-beam up in here that's at an angle, and these two support members at an angle to give us that structural support fore and aft. Now, the weakness in a fifth wheel landing gear is it's not really designed for any lateral movement this way. So we have to come in very straight with our tractor in order to prevent any damage to our landing gear should we not be lined up properly. Okay? Go back to our tractor for a second. You notice here on the fifth wheel, not only is it tilted back as I previously mentioned, but the throat of the fifth wheel is opened up, and the plan then is that the kingpin has to fit in this area so that as we back up into it, the kingpin centers itself and goes into the locking position with the jaws. So that's why we need to be lined up so carefully. You know, if you take a close look and zoom in on this fifth wheel, you can see a little scrub there. That tells me that maybe someone backed in and the kingpin rolled up on there. One of the things that's critical here is that this kingpin is going down the throat of the fifth wheel. One of the worst case scenarios is if you're off center, the kingpin rides up here. If that happens, the kingpin's going to ride all the way up the fifth wheel and drop down in front of it. Now I'm going to talk about checking for that a little bit later in our video here, but that's why it's so critical that this kingpin is being centered. That's another reason that we come in straight. It's much more difficult to get the kingpin properly centered when you come in at any angle to the trailer. Backing into the trailer straight from a straight angle is imperative in order to make sure that this kingpin goes in the correct place, centered into the jaws. And coming in at an angle then, there's more of a risk that it can ride up on the side. So that's why it's highly recommended that you do not approach trailers hooking up to them from any sort of angle. It is done every day. Experienced drivers, if they're very careful, can get away with that. But I want you to understand right from the get-go here is that you are compounding the risk of a mistake if you come in at any sort of angle. You want to come in.
I got to do something real quick here. Sorry to interrupt.
Questions about anything so far?
No.